I just want to say, most of us that are here have known Brother Rodney since 93, and some of his students even years before, in that he was a professor of Bible and Hebrew at Lipscomb for about 40 years. And but there, I'm sure there's a number of you that are here for the first time to meet Dr. Rodney and be in one of his classes. And I know the press release that came out, probably before you read and heard about this special class that he was be teaching, gave a lot of his academic achievements in there, which certainly are great. But I just would want to say that in addition to all of that, it did say that Dr. Cloud graduated from Hebrew Union, which that's the Jewish Institution of Religion, in Cincinnati, Ohio. And they have, I believe, four campuses, Cincinnati, Los Angeles, New York, and Jerusalem. And Dr. Cloud graduated from there in 72. And since then, he's had an illustrious history in teaching, church work, different churches. He's been with us for the last 14 years. And what was not in the article, to me, should certainly, I think you'd want to know, is that last June the 3rd, he was invited to attend the commencement exercises at Hebrew Union in Cincinnati, and was ordered what is named the Graduate Medallion, which is awarded to those that are distinguished in furtherance of scholarship and excellence in education and teaching. And he received that award then, and continues to just do things like this here tonight. And Brother Rodney is just a man of many talents and scholarship. And I know he's had something like 29 tours to the Holy Lands, to Jordan, Egypt, Greece, and Israel, and been on two archaeological excavations. So you've got a very experienced man here in the Bible and Hebrew and Greek, and he's blessed my life for the last 14 years. I know you're going to be enjoy and be thrilled by what you'll be hearing, and I believe that this in the next five or six presentations. Thank you, Brother Rodney.
I had no idea that was going to happen. We're going to pass a sheet on this side. This will be the sheet on this side. And all I need is your name and your phone number. And we'll work out some kind of a tree in case, you know, next Thursday could be tragic. But you just called the church building, and the secretaries all know. There's four secretaries and staff workers, and they all know what to tell you. So if you'll just put your name and phone number. I didn't have but one pad, so this one here, you get to see. This wasn't on purpose. This was bought by somebody else, but there'd be getting the medal for the President of Hebrew Union on the cover. But more important than that, you get to see my little first grandson of 17 years old inside. But you sign right here. You sign right here.
That cost extra.
Okay, folks. And the one that just came in, I'm sure some of them didn't get the handout. Oh, you took care of it. Thank you so much. And we have three books left, and we'll take care of those at the break. I've got 30 more that I are going to pick up. Well, folks, this is exciting. Probably won't do nearly as well since I got that introduction, but this is exciting to be here. This topic is an extremely exciting topic. A few things that have helped me probably with the Bible as much as anything else. Sure, studying the text is fantastic, but after I'd had a lot of Bible, I came to college to be a math major. I didn't go to Princeton, I came to Nashville because they had a Bible school there, and my teachers were very upset that I came all the way to an unaccredited school. It was unaccredited at that time, but I came to find a wife and to study the Bible along with a math major. Took every Bible course they had. 5 years doing that. But what began to really change the depth was you had to have a language to get the math degree. You don't today. And so I talked them and let me take Greek. They didn't want to, But I said, well, I'm here, I came to study the Bible. And have you ever heard the word transfer? And they said, in that case, you can take Greek. Took 3 years of Greek and 2 years, fell in love with Greek, and went on and ended up, you know, so I got a master's in math later, I got a master's in New Testament Greek, and then I went and got my doctorate in Hebrew. But the language study, the Greek and the Hebrew language, come right in, folks. The Greek and the Hebrew languages just did something for me. The next tremendous thing that happened to me, of course, teaching does a lot for you. The next tremendous thing that happened to me was I started going to Israel. I started going to the Holy Land. I started going on digs. And I'll never forget when I came back. I was so excited on my first trip, and I was preaching in Lebanon at a church called Maple Hill, and I was teaching a class Sunday morning, and this lady said to me after my class, she said, well, you were a good teacher before you went away, but you're much better now. This was 2 weeks later. And I said, what was it? She said, I could see the places through your eyes, through your excitement. And what happened was, we were on Joshua chapter 12, where 31 kings are captured, and I had been to 12 of the cities that Joshua captured. And I explained those 12 cities that day. And I knew I was excited, because we just got back the day before. But I didn't know I was coming across that well. But that helped me just tremendously. There was a time when I tried never to make archaeology dull, because it never was dull to me. But there was a time when I taught about the finds and then followed up after we discussed the archaeological find, the Stele of David, for example. That was found in 1993. I and my group walked right by it. It was about a foot under the ground or so at the city of Dan. And we walked right by it. I see some of you have been to Dan here with me. There are several who have been to Israel with me. And this was in January. In August 1993, the Dan Stele appeared with David's name, the first time that the name David ever appeared outside the Bible in extra-biblical information. It occurred in the Bible, many, many chapters, over 40 chapters right together, from 1 Samuel 16 to the beginning of 1 Kings. And it appeared, of course, later in the Bible. It appeared in writings about the Bible, but in actual history outside the Bible, the name David had never occurred. And there was a man named Davies who had just written a book that said David was about as real as King Arthur. And the whole book was to prove that David was not a real character. Well, there, the name House of David was right there on the Stele. And then Stele is simply we'll be explaining these terms, an upright slab. And then, in the next 10 years, the name David was found once on the Moabite stone. It had been missed because the D was chipped off, and we saw in the context it was the House of David. And the third time, down in Egypt, K.A. Kitchen found it. Great scholar at Liverpool found it in Shishak's invasion of Israel. And he said he came to the Heights of David, and there it was in hieroglyphs, you see. And so, but anyway, so now I was walking down the hall one day, and a professor, I guess trying to reduce his library, had books out for sale, didn't have a name on anything, just a little jar, said, put the money here, honor system. And I picked up The Luck of Nineveh, which I'd heard about, but had never read, The Life of Henry Austin Layard. And I finished the book at 4 a.m., and I went home and I meant to read about an hour, and I read the whole book and got excited and started checking out every book on Henry Austin Layard and became so excited about the monuments that he found that you'll be seeing in this textbook of ours, has many of the monuments. So I started talking about the romance of archaeology, spoke at Pepperdine Lectureship, and talked about the romance of archaeology, the actual finds themselves, and then the application. And that's exciting. I get excited every time. Layard was in, he dug at two main cities, and we'll be going through the book in just a few minutes. He dug at two main cities, one you recognize today as Mosul. That's Nineveh. That's the city of Nineveh. At that time, Mosul was on the west side of the river, Nothing was on the right side except these mounds. Two big mounds, one called Kuyunchik, which meant something like sheepfold, and the other mound called Nevi Yunus, which translated means the prophet Jonah. Two hills, two tells. One meaning the sheepfold, or something like that nature, and the other meaning the prophet Jonah. Well, let's see now. If I remember correctly, there was a guy named Jonah that went to Nineveh. And on top of that mound was a tomb called the Tomb of Jonah, where Christians, Jews, and Muslims came on a regular basis to worship. What a coincidence that there would be a mound, a hill called the Hill of Jonah, the prophet Jonah. See what I'm saying? Well, Layard dug, went on down after he didn't know it. He's standing on top of Nineveh. He thinks it's Nineveh from some of his adventures. His adventures are like Indiana Jones. My brother, who retired from Pepperdine, and I wrote a movie, Layard of Assyria. We almost sold it several times. They wanted to change so many things. It grieved me. We worked with an ABC Disney producer. But we spent hours and hours on his life. And it's like Indiana Jones and Lawrence of Arabia, all wrapped into one. This guy, Layard, was unbelievable. And we'll talk more about him later. He went on down, and he's living in a period where it's chaotic, where you could be killed very easily. His workers sometimes would have tribes, Bedouin tribes, riding in and just whack the heads off his workers. And all kinds of chaos, all kinds of temperature, animals, snakes biting them, just malaria, terrible things. And yet, he faced these massive mounds. He went down about 30 miles or so, a little bit less, 23 miles south. And the guide said to him, he said, "What is this big hill here?" He said, "It is called Nimrud," which translates to Nimrod, Nimrud, Arabic, Nimrod, in Hebrew. And eventually he would be able to find, if he would find Nineveh under the other mound, he would find the city of Kala. And someone says, Kala. Is that in the Bible? Yes, it is. Genesis chapter 10. One of the cities built by Nimrod. Are you with me? The mound, 300 acres. Archaeology is an infant science. And under that mound is the city of Kala. Were any important kings there? Well, let's see. There's one named Tiglath-Pileser, the first king, Assyrian king mentioned in the Bible, who invaded and came into Israel and captured much of Israel. Sargon II, whose name is mentioned, and he actually lived there a short time. He actually moved to build his own capital city of Khorsabad. But anyway, he's mentioned Isaiah chapter 20, verse 1. Shalmaneser found his palace. He's the one who attacked and started destroying North Israel. Sargon, his son, his brother, probably his brother, a little debate about that, finished the thing. And then his son, Sennacherib, built a massive palace and made Nineveh the capital. Are you with me? He found every Assyrian king mentioned in the Bible and their palace. Every last one. And people were saying all over Europe and all over America at that time, they were hooking into the modern approach that the Bible was just fables, etc. And they were saying, you know, these Assyrian kings are just made up. They made some pretty fancy names up. And all of a sudden, all those kings, not only did we find their names and their writings, we found pictures of every one of them. And you'll see some of the pictures, even this very night. Okay. And they found a language that they'd already knew was called Akkadian. By the way, that's also mentioned in the same passage with the city of Kala, the city of Akkad, and the language Akkadian, which breaks into Syrian and Babylonian, that you cannot study in a PhD program in Old Testament without knowing some Akkadian. We're offering Akkadian this term. One of my students who's getting his doctorate at Hebrew Union is teaching Akkadian for us, Old Babylonian Syrian. You'll see it. You'll be shocked that anybody could even learn it. Okay, let's leave Layard for a minute. About, three quarters of a century later, there was a man named Sir Leonard Woolley. He was digging at a place called Aleppo. He had a young assistant who was from Oxford, and his name was T.E. Lawrence, scholar in the military. they were not only digging, but I think he was going to be in the military. They were not only digging, they were also spying for the British against the Turks. Sir Leonard Woolley got caught, put in jail for 2 years. Lawrence got away to become Lawrence of Arabia. When Sir Leonard Woolley got out of jail, he went down to a place called Ur. Ur, we say Ur when we talk about the Bible. We Ur when we pronounce it, but that's all right. We pronounce it, it's really pronounced in Hebrew, and in Akkadian it's Uru, and in Hebrew it's Ur. One of my students, let me stop the story a second, one of my students in Montgomery was so upset when this last war started, because he was in the middle of a term studying to be a chaplain, and he had played it safe by going into the National Guard, and they got mobilized in Selma, Alabama, and he got shipped to Iraq, and he was so upset until he sent me an email. When they found out he was studying theology and studying to be a minister and a chaplain, he ended up being stationed at Ur, and they made him the director of tourism, and his job every day was to take the people through the dig at Ur. And he wrote me the most, he said, this is exciting. And when he came back to Montgomery, I let him lecture to one of my classes, because he was so excited about it. Okay? So, anyway, that's the kind of thing. There's a certain amount of romance. Well, let's go back to the 1920s and so on. When Woolley gets out of prison and goes down to Ur, Lawrence is off doing his adventures, and he has a new sidekick, a new assistant named Max Malawan, who ended up getting his doctorate. There was a lady in England who had written some articles and things, and her mother had died. She got divorced. She was really quite upset. So she took the Orient Express over to Ur and volunteered to dig. And a year later, she married Max Malawan and began writing about the digs. Her name was Agatha Christie. And so she wrote, the next year they went up to Layard's dig, and she wrote Murder in Mesopotamia. They went on down to Egypt, she wrote Death on the Nile. And everywhere she went, she did some digging, but she did write it. Now, if that's not a little bit exciting, then you know, maybe your mentality is like a fire plug or something. I don't know. I'm just kidding. But see, there is what people don't realize is there's a lot of romance also involved. There really is. Okay. I've got your names right here. We'll talk about those. We'll try to spend a lot of time on that. And let's go ahead and talk about the handout just for a minute, and then we're going to go to the book. And like I say, I've got three other books we can quickly hand out. Again, you know, some people have to pay, and yet we'll work on that. And then we've got 30 more books at the bookstore in the next couple of days. But here on the first page is the ancient Near East, the picture of the ancient Near East. What do you need? I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's just talk about these pictures first of all. Here is a picture of Mesopotamia. Everybody knows where Mesopotamia is, basically. Even though it has a Greek name, Mesopotamia, middle of the rivers, between the rivers. The word in Greek, potamus, means river. And all of you know that from, because you know that hippos is the Greek word for horse, hippodrome. Therefore, hippopotamus is a river horse. Okay? And Mesopotamia simply means between the big rivers, the Tigris and Euphrates. Layard is going to spend time in Baghdad. He's going to go over and even over to Babylon and look at the Tell there. And again, a couple of my students have been to the Tell. And we had one Black Hawk pilot who came back from Iraq, and he and I did a presentation on Wednesday night on slides, if you remember. But anyway, this is Mesopotamia. Right there to the top, marked out, Mesopotamia, Syria. This area here that's marked It's called the Fertile Crescent. It was named that by an Egyptologist. They blessed it. They didn't. It was really funny. He named it, and take away Egypt, and you can kind of see a crescent if you take away Egypt. Well, he named it the Fertile Crescent. He didn't include Egypt. He was an Egyptologist, which was very strange. So when he died, his friends added Egypt to it, because that's the Fertile Crescent. That's where the green stuff was. Well, where's Assyria? You see it on the Tigris River runs through the heart of it. Babylon, the Euphrates really runs to the heart, although at different times the two empires were controlled both rivers. And then other, Sumer down there, Samaria or Sumer, this is where Ur was. Now what's happened is we have from Layard on, and people like Major Rawlings and others, they dug up all of these artifacts and all these this writing. There was only one little problem about the writing. We couldn't read it. Nobody could read Akkadian. I mean, no one could read Akkadian. They had knew there were inscriptions here and there, and when Rawlingson came up from Baghdad, he was a very important person down there for the East Indian Company, the major then, Carlin, the major. He came up to visit the dig at Nimrud and saw that Layard was primarily collecting these massive monuments you'll see in just a minute. Well, and then some of his workers were throwing the inscriptions in piles. And he said, no, that's the most important, the inscriptions. The writing is far more important than these other things are important, and they'll fill the museums and people will be excited. But if you don't know what these monuments mean, then you're helpless. You need to know. And down in Egypt, just before that, no one could read hieroglyphs anymore. Napoleon took his men over there, and of course his men were very, very helpful. They used the Sphinx face in target practice, but he took scientists with him also, and they found the Rosetta Stone that the British took it away from them. The British blockaded them and took it away from them and ended up in the British Museum. But a Frenchman deciphered it. It had hieroglyphs. Nobody could read. It had another dialect of another script of Egyptian that nobody could read, but it had a column of Greek that many people could read. You understand? And they isolated names because they had put the royal names in a cartouche, a little oval thing, and they noticed that seven times, for example, that you had this combination here, and seven times in Greek it talked about Ptolemy. And it turned out to be right. And they were able to isolate names first and began working like that. It's a fascinating story itself. Okay. We're going to be talking about Mesopotamia, Syria, Palestine. Of course, Israel's in Palestine. Don't be embarrassed if you don't know this, but does anyone know where the name Palestine comes from? What Old Testament people did it come from?
The Philistines.
That's exactly right. And actually, the word Palestine was a division by the Romans, and actually the spelling of the Latin spelling actually appears in the King James a few times. It doesn't say Palestine, it doesn't say Philistines, it actually says the land of Palestine, basically, in Latin, in the early English translations. And then down in Egypt, of course, very important. But other areas like Anatolia, that's where the Hittites lived. In Central Asia Minor, they're very important. Urartu. If you look at Urartu, someone says, well, can you connect that to the Bible? Yes. So the East Semitic spelling is Urartu. The West Semitic spelling is Ararat. And that's where Mount Ararat is. I know you're not archaeologists, but do you dig what I'm saying? Oh, good. Okay. Page 2. You may bring this back with you. We will add on to it. Well, page 2. Let's see. I don't know how the chart got upside down. Let's see. That's okay. Put my glasses on. I see it's okay. This is I thought the chart was upside down, but I see it's not. This is a tell on the right-hand side. What is a tell? Number one, it's spelled in Hebrew, T-E-L, spelled in, T-E-L-L, T-E-L, spelled in Arabic, T-E-L-L. Sometimes they're mixed up. Even a Hebrew dig will sometimes have the Arabic spelling and vice versa. But normally speaking, Hebrew is T-E-L, Arabic is T-E-L-L. It means a ruin, and actually the Hebrew word that appears in the Old Testament, talking about ruins and so on and so forth. But it's from the word for this mound of layers of civilization. I remember I was asking one of my students one time, I said in archaeology class at college, I said, his name is Jamie Boone, I said, Jamie, what do you call if it's this mound has 25 layers, 15 layers of civilization, and is called a tell, what do you call it if there are no levels there? And you immediately hit bedrock near the top. He said, I don't know. I said, the technical name is hill. It's a hill. So that's what it is. It's just a hill. But if it has levels in it, in the 1960s, when the Italian team went to Syria to dig, they had never really found a striking tell like they had found over in Mesopotamia or in Israel. And this Italian was just sure he wanted to dig in a place called Tel Mardi. And everybody said, you know, this is going to cost a fortune. You're going to spend all your money. You're not going to find it. There's not anything in that. That's a hill. He just was positive, so he started digging 140 acres on top. That's pretty good size, right? 140 acres. He found the city of Ebla with a population of 260,000, which was massive in ancient times, and found a king by the name of Ibrum, which, if you put that in Hebrew, it'd be Eber. And Abraham had an ancestor named Eber. And it goes Shem, dot, 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 Eber, dot, 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 Abraham. And it many times we'll stop and say in Genesis, oh, and all the descendants of Eber. It just picks Eber out. And that's also the way you spell the word Hebrew in Hebrew. Off of Eber, it's Ebri. It means somebody who descended from Eber. Is that interesting? Apparently not. I thought that was a big point. Eber this morning, I said, it snows, I'm coming anyway because I've got that point. Now, seriously, isn't that interesting? It is really fascinating. Well, anyway, they found it turned out to be a language that was like a grandfather language to Hebrew, called Eblaite. They just named it Eblaite after the city of Ebla. Okay. Sometimes the place is called, named after the mound, like Nimrud. Sometimes named after the city under the mound, like Kala. And sometimes, like Nineveh, is Kuyunchik. You see the name Kuyunchik? That simply means that's the name of the mound. Okay, or there may be more than one mound there, like in the case of Nineveh. But you can see that you see how they do this. Now, how about these? How about the pottery? We'll say more about the pottery later, but pottery is one of the main keys. And you say, really? For dating. What happens when you find pottery? Now, Sue over there has been on several trips to Israel, and she and I dug at a place called Elwat, 10 miles, roughly 9, 10 miles east of Caesarea and 9, 10 miles south of Megiddo, with Dr. Adam Zertal at the University of Haifa was over that. And that was most interesting. That was really called roughing it because we stayed in a kibbutz that did not have air conditioning. And it was, 97 at night or something like that. We had, if I remember correctly, we had a big cat that came and lived with us. And we couldn't keep him out because we couldn't keep the doors locked or anything. And you guys had a rat, didn't you? Did you find a big rat? And the best I remember, if I have this story right, we took the rat down to chase, the cat to chase their rat, and he took one look and came back up. I believe that was that the story? Something like that. That's the way the story evolved. Okay. All right. Anyway, what do you do? Suppose we decided, here's America, 3,500, we don't want to think about being destroyed, but America is just gone to waste, it's destroyed, or whatever happened, and all these mounds are here, all these places covered with dirt. Well, how did Nineveh get covered with dirt? Well, what's left of the city becomes a collector. I mean, you let your house sit around a year without doing anything to it, and you will be shocked what happens. Just any clothes that a child throws on the floor, don't move it. Any piece of dust that comes in, and also knock a couple of walls out so the dirt can get in, and you'll be shocked at what happens in your house. It's pretty shocking as it is. Am I right? Okay, all right. Well, when Alexander the Great came by, these places were covered. But even before Alexander the Great, in 401, when Zinnemann came marching by Nineveh and Nimrud with his 10,000 Greeks, he noted these massive mounds. Nineveh was destroyed in 612, and yet he came by 211 years later, and the city was totally submerged in dirt. Is that amazing? It really is amazing. Okay. And he gave it some kind of a name, but he had no idea. In fact, he may have been encamped on top of Sennacherib's palace without even knowing it. Okay. All right. So, lost my train of thought. Thank you. I've always never had to fail that a student didn't bring me back. And so, in America, suppose they decided, well, why don't we use Coke bottles and Coke cans to date things? Because you can line up Coke bottles, Coke cans. For when you find a Coke can, you look, okay, how was that made? What's the writing on that? I really meant to do that tonight. I'll try to do that next week. I was going to bring you some Coke bottles. And I was going to say, now, first of all, this one's made of glass. This one's made of plastic. And this one, of course, you can see is some kind of metal, aluminum or something. And then something else on them, I was going to turn them around, show you the writing on there, how important that was. I was going to turn two of them around. One has Hebrew, one has Arabic on it. It says Coca-Cola on the other side, but in the Arabic says Coca-Cola and also in the Hebrew. Does that make sense? And so what happens is, you can date a layer. So what they do is they dig these squares. And if you're in charge on the first dig, I just ask, I just want to be a, even though I have a PhD, I just want to be a worker. The second dig I went on, they made me be a supervisor of the dig, which is much harder because you have to do all the things that they do, plus you have to draw diagrams to stay up half the night doing that while they get to sleep and go swimming when they're finished, the workers. But anyway, you have this square, and it has a 1 meter block. You'll see some pictures of this around it, and that's called a balk. And what happens is, you know exactly where you are. At the top of the balk, you might be, when I dug at I, AI in the Bible, we pronounce it AI in English, it's I in Hebrew. Joshua captured that second on his list, Jericho, and then I. We knew the top of our, we found a wall, and the top of that wall was 2,680 feet or something. I've really forgotten exactly, 2,780 or something. And so you mark that, and then you go down the balk and see a piece of pottery sticking out, let's say a Coke bottle sticking out, and you must mark exactly where you found that. And if you find these pieces of pottery in their setting, and you know that was the setting, then you've got something really nice. That's one of the problems on the antiquities market. There pop up these finds, and the trouble is, like the Dan Steele, nobody except Philip Davies, who'd written a book saying David wasn't a real person. This was kind of a shock to his system. But no one but Philip Davies and maybe one other scholar who's in a home somewhere said that David wasn't a real person. It didn't say House of David. He tried to make it say everything else, and he's about the only one left. But generally speaking, you see, when this kind of thing happens, you find that in part of a wall. They've taken that broken stela and made it part of the wall. And therefore, they were able to date when it was put in that wall. And then the writing told them when it was written, roughly speaking. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And so this is the kind of thing you do. So Coke bottles maybe will help you understand what they do. What else about the pottery? What's it made of? Where'd they get the clay? Sometimes they see the clay came from Cyprus, or sometimes the clay came from this place. How about the shape? See, you're allowed to take pieces of the pottery home with you. You may not have known that. Jordan is too free about it. Israel is tighter, but still you're allowed to take some. On the dig, we would get, the dig Sue and I went on together, we would get back and wash the pottery, and you put it on the table, and then the supervisors then read the pottery. And they are, you know, Dr. Wood, at the dig, and I, we had several guys there who really were very skilled in reading pottery. And so the group would decide, well, I think that's Iron Age 2, I think that's Bronze Age 1, and you put them in different categories. Now, that's one thing. Now, when they're finished and they don't want to take those pieces, then the workers get to come, and you get to go to the stack where your square was, that is, the table where your square was, and you can take whatever you want to off your table, and everybody's taken off their table. Then you can go to their tables and take also. But what don't you take? You don't take a handle. You got a handle on it. Or a complete piece, of course, you don't take. Anything with writing? No. That goes to the Department of Antiquities. So this label, it's got to be shipped to them as quickly as possible. And so when they found the David Stela, or the Dan Stela, there it was, written in 9th century writing. And I'll be bringing that to you. I'll bring a replica to you. But most of you in this room can read David on there. Why? Because the script they used, well, I'll just show you. I'll write House Of, but you won't recognize House Of. I'll write large here. That's House, Bait, Beth, B. This is the Y, comes in English, made a long E, and that became B-E. This is the T, which in Hebrew is a T, but in Biblical Hebrew is a T-H. So this is your word Beth, Hasa. But look at David. Recognize the Greek delta, the Greek capital Upsilon, and the Greek delta. Greek borrowed it from Phoenician, who borrowed it from Moabite. Jonah studied with me. We had a class of young scholars. You were about 8 or 9, weren't you, Jonah? And that group of people just picked up everything. I'd come prepared to teach them, and they had learned everything in half the time I prepared. But anyway, this delta actually came from the Dalet. This means door. And you say, well, I don't recognize that. Well, it's the door of a tent. Mm-hmm. The flap. Ah, now you did. This Upsilon, this was actually a V. Because, see, in English, what happened was they borrowed this to make the small Greek Upsilon, and they borrowed the whole thing to make the capital Upsilon. You see that? Mm-hmm. And then, Malvin had Hebrew with me a few years ago. I was one of my students. And then, this evolved into this letter, later, because they used the U as both a V and a U, and so they developed it into that. So when it was pointed, it became the V, and when it was curved, it became the U, the consonant, the vowel. Isn't this exciting? Okay. And then the old Latin, a word like this, was via. Mm-hmm. But in Middle Latin, this became a V. And they missed their W sound. And so they doubled the U. And therefore, out of this one letter on the Dan Stela comes U, V, Y, and W. All from the same letter. If you have an American Heritage Dictionary, they trace the alphabet at the top. And they'll show you that these four letters all come from the same one. Does that make sense? Now, you probably noticed I was going right to left.
Mm-hmm.
Well, my students like to say, oh, that's backwards. No, it's not backwards. It's right to left. Left to right is one way, right to left is the other. In fact, in hieroglyphs, you can go top to bottom. But anyway, I remember I had this young lady in Hebrew, very bright. Came to graduate school. She was probably about 33, and I just thought she was so bright in other classes and then talking to her. But she made a 0 on my first quiz and a 0 on my second quiz. And this after 2 3-hour classes. And so I said, well, let's meet before class. And she said, okay. She got off work early and came. And where I'm working with her, and she says, oh, it's right to left. She'd been memorizing her words left to right. And that's kind of hard to do, you know, spelling shalom as, putting the M first. So that's kind of tough. It's okay if it's a word like wow, you get away with it. Okay, same way. All right. So you understand what I'm saying. So enough about pottery, but we're getting languages right now. But you can see how valuable the pottery is. And so if it has any writing on it, or if it has or any steel, any mark, anything has a writing, or if it has some kind of shape, that's called designated pottery. In fact, a piece of broken pottery they use to make contract on, if it's just simply blank, you probably can take it home with you. But it might be a marriage contract. Might be a deed that has to stay in Israel or Jordan or wherever it is. It ends up in the Israeli Museum or wherever. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. How are we doing on time? Okay. Okay, we're going to take a little break in a minute. If you look at the third page, these are some of Layard's finds, except one of these things is not. But on the very top there is a picture of a guy sitting on his throne. His name is Sin Achareba. English, Sennacherib. He's the Sennacherib, appears in the middle of the book of Isaiah, beginning in 2 Kings 18, beginning in 2 Chronicles 32. He appears in three stories in the Bible. He was a great king of Assyria. When they were digging up his palace, one man said, I don't know whose palace this is, but after serious study, I know it's not Sennacherib. And when they were able to read the Akkadian for the first time, it said on the outside of the palace, Sennacherib, the great king of Assyria. There he was, Sennacherib, the great king of Assyria. Now, he's sitting on a throne, right? Where is that throne? Where is he? What country is he in? Israel. He's down in a city called Lachish, or Lachish in the Bible. If you'll read the story in the Bible, you'll find out that the Assyrian army pitched their tents near Lachish. We probably two-thirds of the time go to Lachish. If we're in that part, we have to decide, did you go both times to Lachish or one of the two?
I went just the one time.
Okay.
And so last time we didn't go.
We took other sites instead. Went to Azekah, though, which is one of the fortresses not far away. Well, anyway, he pitched his camp there. His men attacked the city of Lachish. He came up to Jerusalem or sent his soldiers, and they threatened the city of Jerusalem. Well, down in Lachish, the city of Lachish fell. And that's what we knew in the Bible. That's all we knew. Well, lo and behold, when Layard was digging, he had to make decisions about what to ship home. A lot of stuff he shipped didn't make it anyway. Pirates attacked one whole shipload of 110 crates at Barsa. Basra, where the British soldiers were encamped, right, to Basra. Mm-hmm. And they warned them not to try it. They didn't want the artifacts. They wanted the wood and the boxes and the ropes and the lumber that made up the ship that they tore apart, and they let the 110 crates sink into the Tigris. 10% was rediscovered, and the rest of it was gone. And that was geared for the British Museum and for the Louvre in Paris, those two places. Well, this was a constant problem. Well, anyway, when they are sending these things home most of the time, they cannot read the Akkadian yet. They began reading the Akkadian a few years after, just a short time after Layard left, maybe. Just as he was getting ready to leave, they started reading. Layard had figured out all eight palaces in order. He had them all in order. He said, I don't know whose palace this is, but his daddy is that palace over there, and his son is the palace up at Khorsabad. Well, it turned out to be Sennacherib, because his son, of course, is Sargon. He's built himself a new palace at Sargon at Khorsabad. And his daddy, Sargon's daddy, his own son built a palace in Nineveh also. So what happened was, he had this, 60, 70 feet of a painting around the wall. Not a painting, but a relief around the wall. It was made of plaster or something. 5 minutes to go before the break. We're going to have a short break. And he liked it. It wasn't the most spectacular thing he saw, but he liked it. So he had it, he shipped it there. It makes up one room in the British Museum today, called the Lakish Room. When Sennacherib got back from Jerusalem, where he had been defeated and his army had been crushed by the Lord, he was so depressed, he was like a, now this could be a guy, I'm going to say a woman, but like a guy, it could be a guy. A woman who's very unhappy, she goes out, takes her husband's credit card and spends like crazy. Or a husband who's unhappy, anyway, whatever the case. And so he got home and he built himself a palace without equal, a brand new palace. And in his one of the throne room, he had 60 feet of comic strip. And I'll bring those and show you. But anyway, you're going to see some tonight very quickly. But it shows the attack on the city of Lachish by the Assyrian army. The next thing shows them shooting at each other, arrows, bow and arrows. It shows the siege machines up against them. The next one shows the walls beginning to fall with the guys up there picking away at the walls. The next one shows prisoners lining up and a group lined up before Sennacherib begging for their lives. Then you see to one side, you see a pile of heads where ones that didn't, the answer was no. You see other bodies over there. I'll show you those in just a minute. People who are stretched out, tied to the stake, and their skin being filleted off of them. That's pictured there too. And this was at Lachish in the Bible, a city 30 miles southwest of Jerusalem. Isn't that amazing? He just happened to, he saved one of the greatest ones. Well, that's Sennacherib on his throne. Where? At Lachish in Israel in Judah. On the right-hand side of that, you see there is a inscription in Akkadian. Now, that's awful small. We'll show you some bigger Akkadian. Guess whose name is circled there? A guy named Mr. Sennacherib. He has a sign of a male in front of his name. That's what that little bar, this is left to right, the little bar. Oh, I started telling you about right to left, left to right. It changed from time to time. But in some forms of ancient Greek, they wrote one line left to right, the next line right to left, the next line left to right, the next line. That is called in Greek as the ox plows. The word is actually from bous and from the verb strepho. And they put those, that's in an English dictionary, you'll find it in an English dictionary. And it means as the ox plows. That's how they read. And when they did that, the letters were shaped the same going both ways. You see? And look at the Greek. I'll use capital. There's A. You can do it both ways, right? Some of the small ones you can see, like Omega, with Omega, capital Omega 2, like that. But a lot of the letters, the Omerkin, the letter P, I know you call it Pi. Mm-hmm. My last year when I went to Hebrew Union, I was teaching two capital classes and two Greek classes, and in Greek it was P, and in math it was pi. The real name of the letter is P. It's spelled P-I, and that's a long I pronounced E. The real name is P, but if you pronounce it that way, like I went over, my girlfriend at Peabody said to me, she had a new medal she had worn or something, and she said, can you read this? And I said, sure, it's something, P something. And she said, P? I thought you knew Greek. It's pi. So I didn't marry her. But anyway, no, I explained to her really what it was, but you know, we said pi. But you can see many of these letters, look at the M. Now, we don't have a lot of time to do this, but in some classes we do this. We actually show you how these letters develop. That is fascinating. I'll just show you a couple of quick ones because our time is almost out. You just say stop, and I'll stop, and then we'll pick up. But here is an ox head with the horns, and then they wrote it faster and faster like that. Greek borrowed that from Hebrew. Greek didn't need an aleph. It's a constant in Hebrew. Turned on its side, it became the Greek alpha and became our A. The omicron came from the letter ayin, I. And when Hebrew came along, Greek came along, they couldn't use, ayin's a very hard letter. And they didn't have anything to do. They said, well, we need something for our O. And so they took the I and made it to an omicron, the baby O. And you saw me write a omega, the big O, that's just two omicrons together. When you write them fast enough, it looks like a W. You see? When the excitement level dies down, I'll continue. Is that a good place to stop? All right. but we will try to be very punctual. I'll stop at 8:30, and then anyone that wants to keep asking questions, stay. I'll stay as long as you stay. Next week, I will be bringing, and I don't want you to worry about ordering these right now. I'll bring enough. I thought I had one with me. I didn't. But Rose Publication puts out these wonderful, they put out big posters, and then they take the main part of the poster at the back, and they make this wonderful little fold-up that goes in your Bible. You can spill coffee on it. This is history of the Bible. This is how the Bible came to us. And this is the life of Paul here. But they have these. They have two now on the Old Testament and two on the New. And I've been trying to decide which one to buy. I get them for $4 tax and all. And I'll bring a stack next week. And again, you're not obligated. They go like hotcakes outside of class. I wasn't worried about the book, getting 90 books. I knew that, in fact, I've had people line up and say, can I have a book? Can I have a book? I'm not going to come to class. I can't come, but can I have a book? But it's one called The 50 Greatest Discoveries of the Old Testament, one's The 50 Greatest Discoveries of the New Testament. And there's two different ones that are very similar. I've got to decide probably the new one I'm going to get because the picture a little bit better in it. They're wonderful. And you put it in your Bible and pull it out. It's just tremendous. The textbook. Two authors here. Al Hirth is the author of, Mark, make sure I show. So, is that your copy?
Yeah.
I'll show that. I won't show it right now, but I want to show that book, NIV, Archaeological Study Bible. It's rather amazing, too. But Al Hirth wrote the book I use in both an undergraduate, a master's level, and even PhD level, called Old Testament and Archaeology. And John McRae, he just retired from Wheaton, and John McRae, who just moved back to Nashville, we had him this summer to speak on Paul's journey, showed a slide presentation. John McRae and I were in college together. He dug at Caesarea 10 years. He's dug at other places. And John wrote the New Testament volume. Well, they came out with this one volume here together, a very popular volume, and that's why we're using it. Both of them are fine scholars, have a very high view of Scripture. And John lives in Donaldson now. His son is a preacher in Donaldson, so he now has retired and lives there. What we're going to do is we're going to just look at the first chapter very quickly and then get you into the second chapter and ask you this week, try to read 1 and 2. It starts off, the picture on the very front says Archaeology in the Bible with a big one there in that chapter. It's actually on page 9, but page 9 is not marked. Some of you were there in November. That's Beth Shan in the Bible. Modern Hebrew is called Beth Shan. Beth Shan. There's a big mound that you can see in the distance. This is on, should find on page 9. You have to find page 10 and go back a page. When Saul and his sons were killed at Mount Gilboa, and when you stand on top of this mount and look, and we trick everybody now. We used to take them in the front door, in the front of it, and they saw, I don't want to climb that mount. And so they would look at the city around it, which is a magnificent New Testament type city called Sycopolis. Only half the group would climb up, but we found a back way where you go up gradually, and you don't know that you're going up. You know you're going up, but you don't think much about it until you're on top. And then we take you to the front, and you look and see the city in front of you, the Old Testament city you're standing on, called Beth Shan. The modern-day city is called Beth Shan or Beth Shan also. But right below you is a marvelous city, and I'm a little disappointed. John put an old picture in here. You won't believe what's happened here, and I'll bring you a picture showing you what's happened. I'll show you a picture taken 45 years ago where there was nothing but trees and grass save a Roman amphitheater. And now two main streets cross each other with columns 3 times the height of this room, almost completely filled in. With so many pieces of the puzzle they haven't even figured out yet, They've got them there. They don't know what to do with them yet. But they gradually are putting pieces together. And the city, every time you go, just gets bigger and bigger. And the buildings are going up as they put the stones back on. Anyway, Saul and Jonathan were killed at Mount Gilboa. And you stand there and see beautiful Mount Gilboa. And his body, the bodies were taken and put on the wall of this hill at Bethshan by the Philistines. The people of Jacob Gilead, who were related to Saul and people whom Saul had saved in 1 Samuel 11, came, their warriors came, fought their way up top, got the bodies, and gave them a decent burial. That story. Well, that's 1 Samuel 31. In the beginning of 2 Samuel, David writes a lament for Saul and Jonathan, and it's an ode to Mount Gilboa. And so you stand on top of Bethshan, read that story, look at Gilboa across the way, beautiful, beautiful Mount Gilboa, and it just comes to life for you. You can't ever read that story again and see it the same way. You just can't do it. It's just so wonderful. A couple of trips ago, we were at the place called En Gedi, the spring of the wild goats, the spring of the ibex. Let's see your hands if you've been to Israel. Oh, pretty good. Pretty, pretty good. Okay. And I was, when I am at En Gedi, it's where David hid in a cave, and Saul came in and he cut off his part of his robe. That wonderful story, 1 Samuel, near the end of 1 Samuel. But I always turn to Song of Solomon 1:14, because here you are. We've been passing through the desert where it rains a half an inch a year. And you come to this oasis, and even though they've cut off 67% of the water for agricultural purposes, it still is a nice, lush waterfalls and still a lot of greenery there. Right, Rosemary? Mm-hmm. And I was telling the story, I told the story of David, and I was reading from 1 Samuel, Solomon 1:14, which says, "My beloved, you're to me like a bouquet of flowers from En Gedi, from the gardens of En Gedi." And this young lady was standing there. Were you on that? Is that the trip, first trip mm-hmm. you were on?
That was the first trip.
She was there with her husband, apparently, and a little boy, and tears were just flowing down her cheek. And I thought, am I doing that bad? Mm-hmm. It was kind of. We'd climbed up the hill, and I was kind of huffing and puffing and stumbling a little bit. Thought it was the poorest job of reading I'd ever done and the poorest explanation, but she was just weeping. So we don't know what happened, but I think maybe they met there, they honeymooned there. There's a kibbutz there where you can go stay. But you'll never read the story of David going to En Gedi and hiding there and read Song of Solomon the same again. It makes sense to you. It really does make sense. Okay. Well, that's Bethshan. We can't stop talking that long about everything. All right. On the next page, there are some blocks for you. There are some squares. Here, you're at Tel Gezer. Later on, we'll tell you the value of Tel Gezer. Several things. This was Solomon's time, present Pharaoh and Solomon at the wedding. But there was a...
Where are you?
I'm on page 10. Yeah. And there's the squares there we were talking about a while ago. And this tell, which is 39 acres, and someone says, "Well, is that what kind of a tell is that? What kind of size?" Well, the old city of David is 15. The main city of Jericho that fell was 15, but then the wall section, Megiddo, which you'd be very impressed with, Armageddon is 15, 20, it's 15, 16, 17. This is 39. When you get to Hazor, 10 miles north of the Sea of Galilee, that tell is 200 acres. That's the city that Joshua captured. And what does it say about that city? It was the head of all the kingdoms in that area. It actually says that in the text of Joshua. And Jabin the king, we have found his name. We found the name Jabin there. They found the palace of the Canaanite kings. And they found now about 10 cuneiform tablets. And I haven't explained cuneiform yet. Oh, I guess I needed to just take a second. I won't take long. Go back to your handouts really quickly, if you don't mind. And we will just quickly show you this. You see the guy below Sennacherib on the throne? You see the guy bowing down before Shalmaneser III? Shalmaneser III doesn't occur in the Bible, but his namesake, Shalmaneser V, is in the Bible. But Shalmaneser III tells us about his battle with a coalition of kings led by Ben-Hadad of Syria and Ahab the Israelites on the Gila of Karkar. And then he lives a long time. In 841 B.C., a king came before him and bowed down. You can tell by his dress, he is a Jewish king. And his name is Jehu. He's king of Israel. He's just killed the king of the north and the king of the south, and became king of the north himself. Much information about Jehu. But we find out he becomes a bad king. What happened? He relied on, not on the Lord, but he relied on Shalmaneser, this powerful Assyrian monarch, and brought gifts to him instead of relying on the Lord. On the Dan Stela, when we first found it, we guessed it was the wrong time, but when we found another piece or two, suddenly we realized it was telling about Jehu killing those two kings. And the Jehu's name is not on there, but the name of the other two kings, the last half of their name, the last half of the king of Judah, Ahaziah, is there. And then it says the king of the house of David. And then it has the part of the name of the king of the north, Jehoram or Joram. And it says the king, Melech Yisrael, the king of Israel. So that's on there. And the stele was set up by Hazael, king of Aram. Probably he took credit for inspiring Jehu to do that. He didn't do it because of Jehu. Jehu didn't do it because of him. He did it because of the Lord. But Hazael wanted to take credit and set a stele up at Dan that he controlled at that time. Right below, that's the Moabite stone. We'll talk about the Moabite stone later. What a fascinating story, though, about the Moabite stone. When it was discovered by a missionary, he showed a little too excitement about buying it. The Bedouins decided over in Jordan, not a good idea to sell it. Negotiated, didn't work out. And so they heated it to a very high temperature and poured cold water on it, and it broke into many pieces. And we have bought the pieces and glued it back together. And even though some names are missing, there's broken parts, and part of it is the name David had the D knocked out. That's how the D got knocked out. Still says house of, and there's a space where a D was, there's a space where, and then VD, and therefore everybody's down, because the top Moabite scholar believes that it. But if you could read archaic Hebrew, you can read the Moabite stone. And if we had the time, I would show you several English letters where they came from on the Moabite stone. And that's too small. We'll get you bigger. See the one circle down near the bottom on the right-hand side?
Mm-hmm.
That's Yahweh. Y-H-W-H or J-H-V-H, whichever way you want to do it. But that's the name, Yahweh. This is unpointed. Moabite was unpointed. And there's the name Yahweh. On this stela, there's the name Israel, the name David, the name tribe of Gad. Amri, king of Israel, he tells about rebelling. Mesha is the king. He tells about in 2 Kings, it tells about he rebelled against Ahab. He was controlled by Amri and then rebelled against Ahab, or at the death of Ahab. On the stela, he says that Amri died and I rebelled against his son. Doesn't mention they have a name, just says the son of Omri, king of Israel. Israel's on there several times. But on that one stela, you get all of this. Does that make sense? It's just incredible. And it's in the stories, in the parallel stories in the Bible, Mesha, king of Moab. On the next page, you will see at the very top those people being filleted there. Unfortunately, the too much ink got on there over, probably Xeroxed over and over. But here these people are tied down, being pulled. And at the bottom, you got a real filleting at the bottom. They're taking them. They may just be choked at the top. At the very bottom there, you see the guys tied to the stake, and their skin is getting ready to be ripped off of them. And then another guy's carrying a head. Anyway, these people are begging for their lives. But some of these are Kuyunchik, which is Nineveh. Some because that's where they were found. The next page is the... this history and inscription. Three languages were found here. Why Elamite was two editions of Elamite, but this was found in Persia, an Akkadian version, which we couldn't read, two Elamite texts, which we couldn't read, but an old Persian, which we could read. And they all said the same thing, same story, written over and over again. High on a cliff, 300 feet above the spring, and Rawlinson hung up there for life and then hired a young Arab boy, did the same thing. And they took squeezes of the Akkadian, especially, but they finally cracked that language when they helped crack Akkadian. The next page, you'll see here's a whole column, the annals from the annals of Sennacherib, and you'll see Sennacherib's name near the bottom down there, Mr. The god, the symbol of the god Sin, the moon god, Akhareba, Mr. Then the one that's circled, though, is not Sennacherib. The one that's circled is Hezekiah, king of Judah. And I locked up Hezekiah the Jew like a bird in a cage, Sennacherib says. I locked him up like a bird in a cage. But unfortunately, God, then the translation's on the side over there for you. But that's Mr. Hezekiah right there. Sennacherib's name, I can find it for you, but we won't bother right now. We'll look at the bottom on the right-hand side, there's a picture of Mr. Tiglath-Pileser, the first Assyrian king mentioned in the Bible. They also call him Pool Right. That was a really puzzling thing for us. Again, how do you apply archaeology? Well, in the King James Version, in 1611, they weren't sure how to handle these two Assyrian kings, Pool and Tiglath-Pileser. And so they said, Pool, the king of Assyria, or Pool, and Tiglath-Pileser, king of Assyria, did such and such. Because they didn't have any historical background outside the Bible. When we learn more about the Hebrew Vav, the V can be translated and, it can also be translated even, also. And when they dug up the records, they realized that Tiglath-Pileser, when he captured Babylon, took the Babylonian throne name, Pool. And he had both names. And the first name he appears in with the Bible is Pool. And Pool came down and attacked, and later said that Tiglath-Pileser did this and did that. Same king. And so now the translations say Pool, a.k.a., also known as, or even Tiglath, they don't have a.k.a., I thought it'd be cute. My wife said sometimes I'm not. It says Pool, also known as Tiglath-Pileser, king of Assyria. That's why it only had one king of Assyria. We couldn't figure out why. One was called king of Assyria, the other wasn't. Same person. Well, see, that made it make sense. That's what happens. In the story of Jeremiah, there was a deal where Necho kills Josiah at Megiddo, famous again, and makes his way up. Well, in the earlier translations, we knew a little bit about the history. We knew Assyria and Egypt were really big enemies. And so the early translations translated, went up against the king of Assyria. Well, then we start reading all the Babylonian Chronicles and all the annals of the Neo-Assyrian annals and find out that Necho came up to help the king of Assyria because he wanted a buffer state between him and Babylonia. He saw Nebuchadnezzar and his father Nabopolassar were the rising stars and had to worry about them, and the Assyrians were crumbling. And he wanted to keep Assyria in between. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Played one of those games, you know, like our American government does. We support some ruler someplace, and sometimes it backfires. Well, anyway, he went up to try to help the king of Assyria. Well, we realized and studied the preposition al. It also means to assist. Now the versions say he went up to assist the king of Assyria. You see how history and archaeology helped us translate that correctly? That's exactly what happens. Okay. All right. Well, I think enough of that. Now back to the text. Look at the role of biblical archaeology. I could have looked at the other page with you. I just want to make a little note here, and we'll fill this in later. Archaeology is no longer by itself. You can't be an archaeologist or have an archaeological dig and know only archaeology. What if you dig up something in Akkadian? You have to have an Akkadian scholar there. Dig up something in Hebrew. You have to make sure people read Hebrew. Dig up something in Greek, in Aramaic. You have to have competent scholars there. What if you need to x-ray something, like a mummy? X-ray, lots of mummies, very few daddies.
Work hard.
Edit that out, would you? Edit that out. You have to have geologists now. You have to have just everyone, people who work computers, really need computers. People have been on digs and know what to do with the information in computers. And it just goes on and on and on. You find plants, you find fossils, you have to have people in just almost every discipline on a dig. And sometimes they don't have that. But you'd certainly need the language experts without any doubts whatsoever. And medical doctors, you need those. In fact, there was this one medical doctor who went on a dig at the Valley of Elah. Do you remember who was killed at the Valley of Elah? Goliath. David killed Goliath. Beautiful places. We went to Zika this last time. You look right on top of the Valley of Elah. Beautiful.
You can see Lakish in the background.
And see Lakish in the distance. You sure can.
On a clear day.
Reminds you of the Lakish letter that says, we no longer can see the fires, the signal fires of Ezekiel, as the letter is written to Jerusalem. We no longer can see the signal fires of Jerusalem. On Ezekiel. And here we're standing on Ezekiel. Well, this doctor was an amateur archaeologist, and they found a skeleton, and this doctor said, you know, I think this guy died 3,000 years ago. And they said, well, that's it. If we determined that from the skeleton, other thing, about 3,000 years ago. And he said, well, I think he died of a heart attack. And they said, you can't tell that. He said, yeah, what we've got to tell you was that there was a little scroll rolled up in his hand, and we unrolled it and read it. It said 10,000 shekels on Goliath.
A free book.
Well, that's a cute little story, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, so he died of a heart attack. All right.
Old Jordanian proverb.
Yeah, we had, this is the second time I've had Naeem as the guide in Jordan, and he would come up with these things, and he'd say, oh, yes, like, you know, remember, like the old Jordanian proverb. Of course, it never would be a Jordanian. He said, like the old Jordanian proverb, that's the way the cookie crumbles. It would be an American proverb if it inserted there. He was a fun guy. Parker was there with us, and he had picked on him a lot, and one day, Naeem, who used to take people on trips for the government, that is, how many times they've been with King Hussein? 59 or something? I've forgotten the number.
I don't recall.
But he said he had a photographic memory to Park one day, because Park was giving him a hard time, having fun with him. And he said, I can remember everybody who was ever on any trip with me. But in your case, Park, I'm going to make an exception and forget you. I got to tell you one of the quick ones.
There's a little footnote to this.
Uh-oh.
What he's going to tell you in the next 6-8 weeks, it took him 40 years to learn.
That's what Park said we got back from Israel. He said, I learned in 2 weeks what everything you learned in 40-something years. He was on this guy, a tour, and the group of dignitaries ran across Barbara Walters interviewing Queen Noor, somewhere near the palace or someplace. And she motioned for him to come over, and so he did. And at the end he said, would you say a few words to the guests? They're from England, they're dignitaries, I believe they're from England. And she said, sure. So she spoke a few minutes to them, and they said goodbye, and they're walking off. And he had not introduced her. He just assumed everybody knew. And so one of the guys leaned over to him and said, who was that lady with Barbara Walters? That's a true story now. That's a true story. Who was that lady with Barbara Walters, the queen of Jordan? Okay. There's a map for you over here. I circled three places just for the fun of it. Chasor up there north of the Sea of Galilee. The 200 acres, Bryant Wood, my friend, that I dug with at I, is up there helping Benjamin Matsor now dig at that site. Dr. Matsor believes that he's a Jewish archaeologist from Hebrew Union, my school. who believes that he's found evidence that Joshua burned it. There's plenty of burned things there, and they're looking for the palace of Jabin and hope to find it. If they do, they expect to find a massive number of tablets, which would be fantastic. Down at, you see Qumran down at the top of the Dead Sea. If you go just west of there, halfway to the Mediterranean, you see Beth Shemesh. Beth Shemesh is where a friend of mine, Dale Maynard, Professor Harding, is digging. He wants me to bring some students to him. We're looking at that possibility. That's House of the Sun. That's where the Ark of the Covenant was taken, and when it came back to the Philistines, and people looked in the Ark when they shouldn't have looked, and things did not go well for them. Well, I showed you a while ago, go back up to just south of the Sea of Galilee, and you see there Beth Shan. That's where, in Mount Gilboa, that's where Saul's and Jonathan's bodies, where they were killed and where their bodies were hung on the wall. And it's just such a wonderful, wonderful trip. I think I'm going to go back just after Christmas this coming year. My wife is, I promised her I wouldn't go back again because she said, well, what can you see else? And we kind of worked out a deal. Big, big, big insurance policy. Okay. Pottery's on the next page you'll see over there, the pottery types. And believe it or not, you can learn how to read pottery very well, and it's still one of the key things. Over on page 17, you see a really tremendous shot of Beth Shan. The sad thing is, I'm not sure why they did put such an old shot in there. Maybe they just liked that shot. But there was a time when there was nothing there but grass and trees. And the theater is behind us here, so you can't see that. But now, it's much more than this. These columns are all like three times the height of this room, and it is really a very well-developed city. Now, if you'll turn the page, you get, again, 18. You see a nice shot of a tale. Now, you'll be reading chapters 1 and 2 next when you come next week. It'll make it a lot easier. But there is different ways to attack a tale. And you can see the squares is one way they did it. There are other ways, successive occupation levels. There are just different ways to go about a dig. By the way, biblical archaeology. Archaeology itself means the study of ancient things. The study of arche is the Greek word beginning. The study of first things, the study of beginnings. One scholar defined it as the study of rubbish. And he meant it in a positive way, but the study of rubbish. But there has been a little battle going on the last few years. Archaeology used to be one big study, and then what's happened is biblical archaeology has become separated. It's those finds that will illuminate and explain the Bible, sometimes prove the Bible, that are dug up. So study of first things, study of beginnings that relate to the Bible to illuminate and to illustrate and to prove that the Bible is the Word of God. So you can see a tell there. The next couple pages, using Teal's chronology, just shows you the reason we're able to do this is because of archaeology. The Bible plus archaeology. The president of where I got my degree, who died just a few months before I graduated, Dr. Nelson Glick, who'd gotten his doctorate under William Clockwell Albright, became a very famous archaeologist in the Negev, the south, and in Jordan. That was his big deal, those areas right there. And he was president of Hebrew Union. He also, a couple years before he died, he was at a dinner in New York, and thinking he was with some Secret Service people he had worked with during the war, because he was a spy for the Allies, just like Sir Leonard Woolley was. And the Germans, he was a German Jew, and the Germans, but he lived in America, so the Germans let him excavate because he was a famous excavator, and of course, what would he care about war? And he mapped out Rommel's positions. And fed them back to the Allies. And that was not known. And at the time, he would have been a hero. But, you know, times change, and people look back and say, what an unethical thing to do to pose as an archaeologist. I guess they wanted to put a sign that said, spy, I'm a spy. But in any case, he was telling this to who he thought was a CIA or some agent, and it turned out to be, they were talking about it, it turned out to be a New York Times reporter or a Time magazine one, so his picture appeared.
It's 8:30.
Oh, 8:30, okay. His picture appeared on the cover of Time magazine where that looked like Lawrence of Arabia, and it caused a little stir. He got some positive and negative letters from people that thinking that was just so unethical. But anyway, he was a great archaeologist. He had a lab at Hebrew Union. Then very quickly, page 26, there at Caesarea, that's where Dr. McRae dug for 10 years. That's always our first stop on our trip to Israel. We go to Caesarea first. Then you see a shot of Hazor. This is the 40, 45 acres on top of the mountain there. There's 40 acres on a necropolis, and then there's excavation around. They haven't even started around yet. They're just on the top, and they keep finding all kinds of things. If you will kind of cruise through that chapter, but concentrate for next week on chapter 2, if you would just turn a second through chapter 2, just turn very slowly, but on a steady basis, you'll start seeing things that will surprise you. Page 37, in the time of Abraham, the Akkad period or the Akkadian period collapses. It talks about the Ur III period. There is a bronze mask that some people believe either belongs to Sargon or Naram-Sin, his grandson. We're not sure which one. Look at the next page. There's the city of Ur laid out. On page 39, there's a ziggurat, a temple tower. This is the Tower of Babylon. A massive one's at Babylon, and that's called a ziggurat. And then as you turn, jump over, and we'll stop in a second, page 42, you see what a cuneiform tablet looks like on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side, there is a tablet, that a stela, that Sumerian kingless. That's written in Sumerian. That was the language that preceded Sumerian, Akkadian. It is a non-Semitic language, but Akkadian borrowed the script. And you see on the one on the left-hand side, that is an account of the creation called Enuma Elish, went on high. It's written in Akkadian. And you'll turn one more page, 45, and you see the Babylonian version of the flood called Gilgamesh Epic. It's all written in cuneiform. We'll talk about that more next week. Page 47, the Code of Hammurabi. We have now many law codes before the Code of Hammurabi. And I just wanted to show you, on page 50, you get a real shot of the black obelisk that was on that one page I didn't say much about, 6.5 feet tall. There's Jehu on page 50, bowing down before Shalmaneser. And I just want you to look at, I guess that's probably, on page 58, we'll look, this is the last place we'll look, 58, there's the Taylor Prism. There are 9 different prisms with Sennacherib's attack on the city of Jerusalem. 9. This is called the Taylor Prism, named after Colonel Taylor in Baghdad. He had bought it before Layard even went there. But that's an exciting, exciting chapter about Mesopotamia. Thank you so much for coming.